Eve had with him in the garden through what happened in Exodus as the Passover, but then basically foreshadowed what happened through Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. Christ came to earth and died for our sins, but he did also more than that. He restored what was broken. He fixed our sin problem. He shed his blood so that we could be forgiven, so that when Christ looks at us, very similar to what happened in the Old Testament, when he looks at us, he doesn't see our sin, yet he sees the blood of Christ that has been applied to our life once we have become a follower. We're going to take this one step further today, and we're going to kind of compare Old Testament and New Testament laws. And we're going to look at this connection between the law of Moses, what it's called the law of Moses back in the Old Testament, and we're going to look and see how Jesus fulfilled that law through the New Testament and through his death, burial, and resurrection. So I want to warn you, this is not my typical style of presenting a message. Today, just like last week, we have tons of material to cover. And so hopefully you will grab a pen from the information booth and participate. All these will come up on the screen. You'll be able to fill in the blanks. We will actually have the answers on the screen this week so that you can fill in those blanks. Let me clear up a little bit of communication for those that are here today, or confusion for those that are here today, and for those that are following this discipleship process once we start implementing it in March. For you that are attending right now, at the bottom and at the end of this lesson, it says for you to, you know, bring this back to the information booth so that you can get the next lesson. Okay, that's in there because once we implement this in March, people are going to need to know how to get the next lesson. Okay, but for you today, you can take this home and read over the scripture. We had about four copies from last week at the information booth. So I want to encourage you to take this home and look at the scripture that's behind all of these points that we're about to go over. But for those that are going through this discipleship process right now, as you're listening to this in the future, I guess, which is also kind of confusing, but if you are a person that has made a decision in our church and you receive this curriculum, then it's imperative that you fill in all the answers and that you bring this back to the information booth so that you can get the next lesson. Now, you can also keep this lesson, but what we're doing is we're bringing a sense of accountability so that we're not just handing out a bunch of information without people actually doing what's required of them. So if you're going through this process later in March when we start this, you need to fill this out, complete it, bring it back to the information booth so they can check and make sure it's complete, and then receive the next lesson so that you can continue in this process. Is everybody clear on that? Yeah. All right, good deal. So that was a little confusing last week. But let's get started. My head's going to be down. I'm going to be reading a lot. That's why it's important that you're actually filling stuff in so that you don't get bored and fall asleep. Because if you're actually paying attention and going through here filling in answers, you won't get bored. So if you need another copy, men who only have their wife having a copy, I know how it works, brother. Yeah, if you need another copy, there's plenty at the information booth for you to get, men. Come on, Steve-O, I'm watching you. All right, that's how comfortable I am with a lot of people at our church. I can call you out. So let's get started in this. The first is an introduction, so it'll give time for those to get settled back down. But let me just start with this. Anybody remember getting their driver's license as a teenager? Yes, anybody remember that? You remember how awesome that felt, having that freedom just to go and do anything that you wanted to drive over to your friend's house, to just go and drive, just to get away from your parents. You remember that feeling? Well, I remember getting my driver's license as a teenager, and for the first time, I was able to go wherever I wanted to drive. I remember the freedom I felt when I received that small card in my wallet. The one thing that was bad about this experience was that I still was using drugs with my buddies. More times than I can count, we traveled around with some form of drugs in my vehicle. Every time I passed a cop on the side of the road, I would try to look innocent. I'd put on this innocent face, you know, however that looks. I became good at keeping tabs on them in my rearview mirror. I would feel nervous and scared when one of them got directly behind me. The fear of the law was a direct result of my guilty conscience. Today, it's not the same. I will pass a cop if he's going under the speed limit and look them in the eye when I pull up next to one at a red light. Anybody ever done that before? Going down the freeway and you got a cop that's doing like 60 and the speed limit 65 and you're wondering why nobody else will pass him? I don't care. I'm not scared. I ain't got nothing to hide. I'll go right past him and do the speed limit. And if he wants to pull me over, then fine. But I didn't do anything wrong. Yeah, I'll wave at him. But I'm not scared of the law anymore. So I'll even look him, even if I pull up beside one at a red light, I'll look him in the eye and like, what's up, man? You know? I will even go as far as thanking them for their service if I see one in a restaurant or a gas station. This is something that I would never do as a teenager. Today, I have a different perspective about police and the laws that they enforce. Now I understand without them doing their job in the area in which I live, it would be a crazy, lawless area. I never understood why they were called peace officers, but now I get it. The laws are just words on a paper if they are not enforced. There can be no peace with words on a paper, but only when a person is willing to lay down his or her life and put his or her life on the line to make sure that those words matter. Peace can be experienced by many. This is the story that we're about to go over of how Jesus fulfilled the law, bringing peace to all of our souls that follow him. So number one, we finished last session knowing that God was teaching mankind his ways. This became known as the law of Moses. It started off with 10 commandments and over time became more and more complicated. In fact, there were a total of 613 laws that can be found in the first five books of the Bible. The first five books of the Bible were Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. And collectively, they are referred to as the Torah or the Pentateuch. These books are the most studied and highly revered books of the Bible in the Jewish culture. 613 laws. That's a lot of laws in five books. Number two, the reason there became so many laws is because God began to get very specific with his people. A great example of this would be my two-year-old son. You see, up until a couple of weeks ago, he couldn't open doors, but now that he knows how to turn a doorknob, this changes things. We have to be specific about what doors he can open and what doors he can't. The door that leads out to the front door is one that is completely off limits. We live at the front of our neighborhood and cars go zooming by quickly. This is a danger that we have to teach him to avoid. He can open the door to our bedroom, but he cannot open the front door. And I want you to get this, because in other words, there are do's and don'ts to the rules. That wind is booking outside today. There are do's and don'ts. Everybody say do's and don'ts to the rules. This is the same way that God established the laws in the Torah. As you move from the book of Exodus to Leviticus, then on to Numbers, things change. The level of understanding becomes more complex. And this goes in everything in life. And I'm going to tell a story at the end of the message today to help illustrate this. But the level of understanding, think about it. Up until this point when the laws were given, people had no idea how to, you know, get rid of sin. They had no idea what was good to eat, what wasn't. They had no idea what was expected of God. All they knew is that God was big, God was strong, and God parted the Red Sea so that the Israelites can get through. And there was a lot that was unknown about God. So the level of understanding becomes more complex. And with that, God begins to teach people specifics about how to bring a good sacrifice for sin and also what not to do. He teaches them about things that are clean and good to eat, along with things that are unclean and bad for you to eat. He even goes as far as establishing some common sense laws about how to be a good neighbor and what to do to avoid your neighbor taking you to court. In fact, if you want to get technical, out of the 613 laws, there were 365 negative laws. These were laws that said, don't do this. On the other hand, there were 248 positive laws. And these were laws that said, do this. We like to think of sin, number four, we like to think of sin as doing something wrong. And we regularly place more emphasis on the don'ts instead of the do's. God has displayed that He is just as concerned with what people do as He is about what they are not supposed to do. And because of this, sin can be divided into two categories. The sin of commission and the sin of omission. The sin of commission is what God said not to do, and we do it anyway. The sin of omission is what God said to do, but we do not do it. Like I said earlier, we tend to focus on the sins that we commit instead of the sins that we omit. Trust that they are both important. For example, when it comes to raising a family, we want our children to be obedient to our instructions just as much as when we instruct them on what not to do. Think about that for a moment. Think about how many times you tell your kids to do something. Go clean your room. Go do your homework. Go do this. Go do that. But a lot of times when it comes to sin in our life, somehow or another, we always focus on the things that we're not supposed to do. And those are important. And we do also get onto our kids for doing something that we told them not to do. But I believe that we should give equal, the word I'm looking for, we should look at them equally and say that there are times that God talks to us, that God speaks to us, that God moves on our spirit for us to do something, to talk to a person, to help a person, to buy a person's lunch, to give somebody something that is sometimes precious to us, or whatever it is. And we just step back and go, nah. But then we feel bad when we go off and we go do something that we know better that we're not supposed to do. Number five, if you take the time to get to know some of the laws that were put into place in the Old Testament, you might think that some of them sound weird. For example, there were laws about clothes, meat, tattoos, shaving people's beards off their face, and the list literally goes on and on. One thing that we have to keep in mind is the culture and the time in which God established these laws. If you were able to jump back in time, just 50 years, listen to this. If you were able to jump back in time just 50 years, you couldn't ask somebody to email you something or even ask them to meet you at a local coffee shop. Those things weren't around 50 years ago. And think about this. The first triple bypass surgery was performed in 1960, which means that technology and modern medicine have changed the world that we live in. So if you want to understand the laws in the Old Testament, you have to see them through primitive eyes. Number six. In those early years, we learned that God used man to build a temple. The temple had three parts to it. And it is in the inner part of the temple that God called the Holy of Holies, where the presence of God would dwell. God would use righteous men called high priests to enter this inner part of the temple and meet with God. In there, he would accept the sacrifices of the community and temporarily forgive people of their sins. There were strenuous procedures that the high priest had to go through to be clean, even to enter the Holy of Holies, or they would die. Mankind could not meet with God in his presence. Only the high priest could. During those times, you had better make sure that you brought the best offering, or the whole community would know and your family would be punished. Totally different times in the Old Testament, but if you brought an animal to be sacrificed at the temple that had defects or that was blind or was three-legged or whatever the case may be, then you'd be in big trouble. And not just by the high priest, by God himself, because he didn't accept those sacrifices. Later on, in the book of Malachi, God would send a messenger to reprimand a high priest for not doing their job correctly. He would use this one person to remind them of the standard and condition that the sacrificial animals needed to be in. The name Malachi means messenger, and God's message to the high priest was that your prayers were going unanswered because they had forsaken the process God had in place. This was a sharp reminder that they could not just go through the motions and everything would be okay. God was not interested in their leftovers. He was interested in their best because sin was costly, and eventually it would cost God his own son, Jesus. Number eight. History records reveal that there were 400 years between the book of Malachi and the book of Matthew. And for those listening, the book of Malachi is the last book of the Old Testament. The book of Matthew is the first book of the New Testament. So there was 400 years between those books. Ultimately, God would go silent for 400 years before he would send his son to earth. And when we begin to look at the first four books of the New Testament called the Gospel, we see the same method in place. There was still high priest doing God's work on earth, but at this time, they were more organized. During the time when Jesus walked the earth, there were a group of 23 to 71 men appointed in every city to a council called the Sanhedrin. This council would meet regularly to deal with religious and political issues of that time. This was a council of powerful priests who had their hand in government too. Eventually, this would be the council of men that would play a role in having Jesus sentenced to death. Number nine. The Sanhedrin were made up of two prominent religious groups called the Pharisees and the Sadducees. These groups had their differences about the Torah, but they both put extreme emphasis on works. They would use the Old Testament laws to enrich themselves while at the same time holding people to a standard they themselves never lived up to. In fact, they would go out of their way to make themselves look religious, praying on the street corners and babbling on about the law, never living up to the standard to which they preached. Jesus called them hypocrites. And get this, the reason why he called them hypocrites is because they talked a good game, but their hearts were far from God. They talked a good game, but their hearts were far from God. Number 10, in those days, the people who knew the most about God and his laws were the most concerned about their power and influence rather than helping people. And the system was broken, and God knew it. The same people who were educated the most about God didn't even recognize his son, Jesus. God was about to establish a new covenant with man, and he would use the people in power to execute his plan. For thousands of years, the laws established in the Torah were good, but they were temporary. The Ten Commandments would transcend time, but so many of the other laws were no longer necessary. Everything that had been established was about to be fulfilled. Number 11. It's important that I say this right, and it's just as important that you understand it correctly. Jesus came not to abolish the law, but to fulfill the law. Man, that's tiny writing. Jesus came not to abolish the law, but to fulfill the law. Without the law, we would not know what is right and wrong. There would be many laws that were created because of the time and culture in which the people lived. But on the other hand, there were many laws that were important to understand. Take, for example, the rules that you had to follow when you lived with your parents. Some of those rules you no longer have to follow because you're now an adult. But those rules helped shape the man or woman that you have become. I had a curfew growing up in my parents' house. But now as an adult, I don't have a curfew anymore. I had a curfew growing up in my parents' house, but now I don't have a curfew. The rule was good for me when I was younger because it helped prevent me from getting into trouble. A little bit. But as an adult, I know that a lot of crimes are committed at night. And there is really no good excuse for running the streets at night. That one rule may not apply to me anymore, but I understand why it was important. This can be said about the law of Moses created in the Torah. A lot of them do not apply to us anymore, but it's important that we understand why God established them in the first place. Number 12, through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, the laws in the Old Testament were fulfilled. Jesus is the sacrifice the law required. He is our high priest who came to earth and lived a righteous life. You see the tie-in now? All the stuff in the Old Testament that's going on, the sacrifice, the high priest going into the temple, this was all fulfilled through Jesus. He did not leave us alone. He sent his Spirit, called the Holy Spirit, to live in us. That means that he no longer dwells in the Holy of Holies. His Spirit dwells in our body. Our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, and we can boldly approach His throne of grace. We do not need a person to do our bidding for us. We have direct access to God through Jesus. We no longer have to depend on a person to go to God on our behalf. We are encouraged to pursue a relationship with God as an individual. When we seek after the things of God, He shows us our faults and challenges us by His Holy Spirit to do better. Number 13. This is probably the most important point. It's the one I like the most. It is our faith in God that saves us. And it is our faith in God that changes us. The Pharisees and the Sadducees always used good works as a path to salvation. But they neglected the most important things like helping people. By doing this, they had control over people and used their works to condemn them for not doing enough. Doing good works is important, but it cannot save you. Only faith in God brings true salvation, and doing good works is a byproduct of your faith in God. Some people say they believe in God, but their actions do not line up with their belief. They are the example of a modern-day Pharisee who proclaims God with their mouth, but their heart is far from Him. Other people do good works, but do not pray or study God's Word or even have a relationship with Him at all. They rely completely on their works to save them, but no one can be saved by works alone. The biggest dilemma, number 14, the biggest dilemma you will face as a follower of Christ will be your ability to obey. The biggest dilemma that you will face as a follower of Christ will be your ability to obey. Your obedience will be tested all the time. All the time. As a follower of Christ, you now have the Holy Spirit in you, and He is trying to work through you. To be led by the Holy Spirit is the highest priority of any Christian, and it is always a battle between what God wants to do and what you want to do. It is the battle between His Spirit in your flesh. We strive to follow Jesus, but fall short. All of us do. The devil is right there when you fall short and condemns you because of what you did or did not do. God does not condemn you. He loves you. He loves you so much that He fulfilled the law so that the devil could not condemn you for not following it. Number 15, understanding the Bible is the single most important thing a Christian must devote themselves to. It can seem intimidating, but the moment that you dive into the Bible, it will be the moment that a whole new world of wisdom will be opened to you. You must devote yourself to this process and devote your life to God because He is devoted to your salvation. In the next session, we will be taking a real look at what it means to follow. In the next session, we'll be taking a look at what it means to follow. Now, there are a lot of scriptures in the back, and I have some notes in here of some more scriptures that I have to add. Those will be added to the final draft, but I just want to elaborate a little bit and end on a little bit more relaxed note. Most of you know and are aware that I love fishing. Here recently, we sold our rent house in spring, which afforded us the opportunity to do a lot of things, pay off a lot of bills, and also buy a good boat. Because my wife is awesome. okay? I told Gucci the other day, I was like, we have some awesome wives, right? I said, you got a new Harley sitting out there, and I got a new boat in my storage unit, and our wives are awesome because they let us do things that we enjoy. And, of course, we do too, but, you know, a lot of times men's hobbies cost more than women's, except when it comes to shopping for shoes. But so anyway, got a new boat, and there's a lot to learn. I've never been a boat owner before in my life. I've been on boats many times. My dad and my brother, I grew up, my dad always had a boat. Never owned one myself, never drove one myself. I mean, I might have drove one across the, my dad's across the lake one time, but never had the responsibility of owning my own boat. And there's a lot of responsibility that comes for it, or that comes with it. I've seen many pictures and heard many stories of people that have crashed into rocks or sunk their boat or done something stupid because they were just careless and didn't pay attention on the boat. So I've been what I call, I tell all the fishermen I see whenever I talk to them, I've been landlocked for 5 years, all right, when it comes to fishing. So every time we would go to Galveston or anything, I was always landlocked. I had to fish off of a pier, I had to fish off of the rocks, I had to go to Seawolf Park. I was always landlocked on, and that made it very limited to what I could catch and what I could, where I could go, because if the fish aren't biting, you know, what are you going to do? You either pack up and you leave, or you go somewhere else, or, but that's always a trouble when you're carrying 100 pounds of equipment with you to Galveston. So you pretty much just stay there and hope that they start biting. In a boat, it's not like that. Dude, if you want to leave, you just start the motor up and move on. And it's awesome. And you just go where the fish are. And it's awesome. But I have this desire, man. And it's and people like kid me about it, you know. They even say, man, you talk about fishing, I always see fish and everything else. I'm like, dude, I like to fish. Leave me alone. You know? You like to do whatever you like to do. You know, I love to fish. So I have this desire to go offshore, okay? And I've been out on like a charter, big, huge charter boat offshore, but you know, there's their own captain. You're standing there like this next to somebody fishing. It's not that fun, you know? But I have a boat now that has the capability of taking me offshore. And when I'm talking about offshore, I'm talking about like 30, 40, 50 miles off the coast of Galveston or Freeport, all right, where the big fish are. That's right. And I'm telling you, I'm looking so forward to it. I'm ecstatic. I don't know if you've ever, you know, done something that you you look forward to doing something so much that you just are excited about when it comes. But the truth is that I have a lot to learn before I take my first offshore trip. I think it would be careless, irresponsible, and literally reckless of me to have bought my boat in September, October, and taken it directly offshore without having the electronics that I need, without having some experience under my belt, and so on. It would have been. And the truth is that it could have cost me my life if I'd have done that. Going offshore is not a game. You have to know what you're doing. You have to have some experience under your belt. You have to have the electronics to be able to handle to get back to shore and so on, or to call a distress call if you get out there and it gets crazy. So for the last several months, I've been doing a lot of research. I subscribed to some fishing magazines. I've been reading a lot online. I've been trying to go out, take my boat on Lake Conroe and even out to the jetties out in Galveston to learn a little bit more about handling it and so on and so on and so on. And just yesterday, I went to a seminar, a five-hour seminar on fishing. Now, that's the first time I ever done that. That's when you know you're serious. All right. And I have to tell you something, man, it was awesome. Like, I went to a five-hour seminar on fishing and paid $55 to go. But check this out. I won a brand new Yeti ice chest. Yeti. Yeti, not Yeti. Yeti. Hey, it's pretty close, but I won a brand new Yeti ice chest and a door prize at the seminar. And let me tell you something, that $55 I paid for the seminar was well worth going, because those Yeti coolers are like $300-$500 a piece. Those things aren't cheap, dude. And so I won that as a door prize, and I was really excited. But let me tell you something, guys. I'm sitting in that seminar, I'm listening to guys that have 30 and 40 years experience on catching fish. And not just catching fish, like the fish that I'm used to already catching around the galaxy. I'm talking about going out and catching, man, dolphin and cobia and snapper and all those fish that are offshore. And they're giving me great tips. I had 4 pages of notes by the time it was all over with, because they're showing you how to rig lines up, and they're showing you what not to do, and they're telling you that there are different fish at different depths, and if you're going to troll, you have to know all that. Otherwise, you're going to go out there, and you're going to spend a lot of money in gas, and you're not going to catch jack. Well, you may catch an amberjack. But there are a lot of different fish, and they all have different habits. And so, to be honest with you, when I left there yesterday, I was a little bit overwhelmed. I was like, God, like, there's so much to learn. There's so much to learn before I go offshore. And I got to go home today, and I got to type up those notes, and I got to make sure that I look them over again, because I want to have the greatest trip. I want to be safe. I want to get the electronics I need. And I want, listen to this. There is always a greater level of accountability when there is a greater level of understanding. There is always a greater level of accountability when you have better understanding about something. And some of you understand this because you go to work. And you may sit there at work and you may be going over a spreadsheet or whatever it is, if you're in Microsoft Word or whatever it is, and you're going over this and you figure something out. You figure out in Excel how to make something multiply or take a percentage or whatever it is. And once you learn that at your job, you can't just ignore it. You can't just sit back and go, well, they don't pay me enough, I'm not going to do that anymore. Because the level of understanding is greater than before, now comes the level of accountability. Let's stand to our feet as we close. And during this process, if you're listening to me through this audio series, during this process, your level of understanding will go up and up and up and up. You understand why Jesus came. You understand that sin is costly and the wages of sin is death. You understand that there was a plan from the very beginning when Jesus came, or when God created Adam and Eve. There was a plan all that way to restore this relationship. And because you have that level of understanding now, you will be held to a level of accountability. The things that you know can no longer be ignored. So I challenge you, as a believer here today and also listening to this series, I challenge you to stick with this process. I challenge you to make sure that as a follower of Christ, as a believer for 10, 25, whatever it may be, years, I challenge you to live to the level of your understanding, to be accountable to what you already know. And that is what we are held to. If we understand that there's a process to sin, then that spirit that lives in us as a believer ought to be listened to, ought to be given attention to. Let's bow our heads as we finish this message. Father, I thank you so much for what you did for us. I honestly pray, God, that this discipleship curriculum finds its way into many different hands. And I pray that the level of understanding will increase in people. And God, I just pray that as we go through this process and learn it as individuals, that the one thing that would resonate out of everything would be how much you love us. I pray, God, that we would understand that everything that we're learning and everything that we went through and everything that has been done in the Old Testament was done out of love. And then the ultimate display of love was when Jesus Christ left heaven to come to earth and wrap flesh and put flesh on his body and experience what it's like to be lonely and experience what it's like to be beaten and experience everything that as humans we now feel. God, I pray that that sacrifice that was made over 2,000 years ago on the cross would always keep us devoted in our level of learning, in our level of understanding, but most importantly, in our level of accountability. Use us to do great things. This year, I thank you so much for what's coming up this year, the different outreaches that our staff is planning. I pray, God, that you would bring new believers, people that come in here that don't have the level of understanding, that we could help disciple them. I pray that the people that have that level of understanding would jump on board, because we understand, God, that the harvest is plenty, but the laborers are few. All of this, God, I pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Let's give God a hand clap this morning, church. So we're going to continue next week. Before you're dismissed, if you would, prepare to give. Our ushers are standing up front here. If you need an offering envelope, raise your hand. They're going to be putting buckets on either end of the stage. And when I dismiss you at that time, you can come up and give and also go home or hang out and talk or whatever you want to do. So there's a couple of things coming up. Next week, everybody say next week.
Next week.
Next week's a busy week. We have our E3 fellowship. For those that don't understand or don't know what an E3 fellowship is, it's basically a potluck after service. Okay, so we encourage everybody, which is what the E stands for, everybody to come, everybody to bring food, and then everybody to stay after in fellowship. So that's what E3 stands for. Also, next Saturday, we're going to do a men's breakfast at my house. So if you men want to come and eat some really good breakfast, I'll make sure that I got plenty of bacon and sausage and all the good stuff that us men like. So there is a sign-up sheet back there now. If you could just put your name on there, that's all we need. That lets me know that you're going to be there. It lets me know how much food I've got to buy. Other than that, this is something that I want to clear up as well. Next week, during the service, or when you walk in the front door, you'll be given a small group sign-up sheet, okay? I understand life gets busy and that sometimes we can't always commit to small group, okay? But one of the things that we want to do this year is we want to do at four times throughout the year is we want to do a four-week like get-together where people sign up for small groups, and then there's 4 weeks where we say, okay, these 4 weeks we're going to commit to going to small groups. And those 4 weeks might be consecutively, like every Friday, just depending on the small group. They may be every other Friday, just depending on the small group. But what we're going to do is we're going to go through a series, a four-week series, on a book called The End of Me. And this is a book by Kyle Idleman. I don't know if you've ever heard of the book called Not a Fan. If you've never read that book or had it, it's a great book. But same author, but we're going to have a four-week series that we're going to do on that. And so I'm asking everybody that can to sign up to a small group and commit to those 4 weeks. So that way we can get together as a church group. We can all be on the same page. We can all have some fellowship outside of just the one Sunday morning service that we do. And it's really, really good for growth. It's really, really good to make connections. So that's next week. When you walk in, you'll have a sign-up form so you can sign up for that. That can just be turned into the offering after service is over with, and then we'll contact you on that. Other than that, y'all ready to give? All right. Let's bless the offering so we can close out. Father God, we thank you so much for this offering. We thank you so much for the ability to come and give back to you what's really already yours. I pray that you would bless it, that everybody that gives will be a cheerful giver and not giving under compulsion, Father Lord, because your word says that you absolutely love a cheerful giver. So I pray that you'd bless this offering. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody say amen. Amen. All right. God bless you. We'll see you next Sunday for our E3 fellowship. And all kinds of other stuff that's coming up.